worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here moving in a mist. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Hey, we make a miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. I worship you. I worship you. You are here turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Hey, we make a miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. That is who you are. Hey, we make a miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You wipe away all tears. You mend the broken heart. You're the answer to it all. Jesus, you wipe away all tears. You mend the broken heart. You're the answer to it. I worship you. You are here meeting every need. I worship you. I worship you.
A very good morning to you all. I'm so pleased to welcome you to join our worship at St. Albans Salvation Army. Wherever you are, whoever you are more than welcome to join our worship. As we just sang, we praise the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, and the light in the darkness. That is our God. May our God touches every heart and heals every heart, whoever comes to him through this worship. Today is a very special day for the Salvation Army, We start our annual appeal called Self-Denial for fundraising to the work of God in the world through the Salvation Army. It runs for 5 Sundays from today, and some weeks overlap with Lent before Easter. So it is very meaningful for us to think of Jesus Christ and his sacrificial love for us. We are going to watch specially produced video clip later, which will briefly explain what self-denial means and how the funds raised will be used to help the world. Your sacrificial giving means a lot, and your love shines beyond what we do. Through this worship, may God touch our heart and lead us to see what He sees and give ourselves to Him to be used for His works.
Darkness, breathe on this flame. expands brightly again until the nations learn of your ways. Seek your salvation and bring you their praise. God of the
Hello and welcome to the first of our films for this year's Self-Denial Appeal. My name is Ben Cottrell, and as we live through the various lockdown measures in place across our territory, I'm going to be looking beyond our borders. For this year's Self-Denial Appeal, I'm going to focus on some of the places we've featured in previous appeals and catch up with people we've met along the way to find out how they've been coping during the pandemic. But first, let's look at last year's appeal. Last year, we travelled to the city of Ouagadougou in Burkina Faso. We met Andre and Nana Togo and saw some of the amazing things that they're doing there. We saw a thriving corps full of enthusiastic new soldiers, and we saw how the Salvation Army is supporting people in the local community. You gave generously once again. Thank you so much. Your self-denial money is already being put to good use. And as a little reminder about how self-denial works, here's Ashley Bowles, who presented our films a couple of years ago.
The money you gave through self-denial is used to support the mission of the Salvation Army around the world, including our mission partners. The idea of self-denial was first introduced in London by William Booth in 1886. He said, "Go without something and give what you would have spent to the Salvation Army's work." That was over 130 years ago. Now, nearly every Salvation Army Corps the world over plays its part. So if you are giving in London, Llanelli, Larn or Lockerbie, you are joining with Salvationists in Oslo, Ohio or Ouagadougou, which is the capital city of Burkina Faso. The money is redistributed by international headquarters to the places that need it most. It funds the background things, the not so exciting but essential things, so that Salvation Army staff and volunteers can get on and do what they're good at. Like the work in Burkina Faso.
Well, as Ashley has reminded us, some of the self-denial money you raised goes to our mission partners, but quite a lot goes to other mission support work all over the globe. Mission support was crucial in enabling the work in Burkina Faso as the seedling Salvation Army took root and began to flourish. For over a year, I've had the privilege of working for the International Development Team at Territorial Headquarters. It's given me a further insight into the international work of the Salvation Army, and I've been involved in some of the projects which have been funded by self-denial. I live here at William Booth College with my wife Rebecca and our two children. And in a few weeks' time, we'll be moving to a corps in East London. But this time last year, we were waiting for visas to go and work in Pakistan. Like so many other people around the world, our plans were disrupted by the global pandemic. Of course, lots of people have faced real hardship, and while it's been frustrating for us, we are well and healthy, so we are grateful for that. As we adjust to this change for us, and as we think about self-denial, I want to find out about how the Salvation Army around the world has adapted. So for the next 5 weeks, we'll be revisiting some of the places we've been to before. I'll be asking people how they're coping and what life is like where they are. I'll be talking to Fozia Columbus in Pakistan. She featured in 2016 when Kerry Coke visited the Salvation Army's territorial headquarters in Lahore. I'll be talking to Melinda Boone from the Philippines. Melinda features in the Salvation Army's Helping Hand Appeal films from last year. She works in anti-human trafficking. I'll be talking to Richard Bradbury. Richard and his wife Heidi have been serving in Bangladesh for the last 2.5 years. They're there with their 2 children and work at headquarters in Dhaka, the country's capital. But next week, we'll pick up where we left off last year. I'll be talking to Nana Togo, who we saw in Burkina Faso. I'll look forward to seeing you then.
I will now read from John chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. True blindness. Walking down the street, Jesus saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, causing him to be born blind?" Jesus said, "You're asking the wrong question. You're looking for someone to blame. There is no such cause-effect here. Look instead for what God can do. We need to be energetically at work for the one who sent me here, working while the sun shines. When night falls, the workday is over. For as long as I am in the world, there is plenty of light. I am the world's light." He said this and then spit into the dust, made a clay paste with the saliva, rubbed the paste on the blind man's eyes, and said, "Go, wash at the pool of Siloam." The man went and washed, and he saw.
Grace, peace, and wisdom be with you all from our God. Let us pray together before sharing the message. Heavenly Father, we come before your living word now. We humbly ask your wisdom so we can see and practice. Help us understand things in your eyes. We ask for your blessing upon those who are listening to this message, wherever they are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. As you know, under lockdown, preparing and delivering food parcels to families in need is one of our important missions these days. Among them is a family, a mother with three children. They have been receiving food parcels over the last couple of months. Due to the pandemic, which affected their work and financial situations, the family was struggling. Whenever we delivered, we briefly left the parcels outside the house and came back, sometimes without opportunity of sharing some words. We know it is not always easy to talk with others when things are really hard for them. We have kept them in our prayers as we do for all those who we share the food parcels. But yesterday, when we came to them, the mother came out with great appreciation. She even said she really wants to come to the hall to have a coffee with us when things get better. They want to know more about us as a church. That was a great joy. They, in the end, could talk to us, opening their hearts and taking us as their friends. For me, that was a kingdom moment. I often experience the kingdom moment unexpectedly when things are really tough in sufferings. To me, such moments are a presentation of the kingdom theology in which we come together in God, regardless of our differences of social, physical, cultural, financial situations. When we were on our way back home after the delivery, the children of the family also came out and waved us. How lovely! In the many kinds of suffering we experience today, what do you really see? Broken society, broken system, a greedy system, economic hardship, broken relationship, isolation, poverty, along with some silver linings like the NHS, key workers at the front lines. The question I have just raised is the crucial question across the New Testament and the whole Bible. What do you really see? Let us bear this question throughout the message. When we open the scripture today, we see a man blind from birth. What do you see in him? Jesus and the disciples, they went along and came across him. They stopped in front of him. Then the disciples asked Jesus, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? In today's standard, it is very rude and shocking to be direct like this. They could have asked instead whether he is okay, where is he from, or how he carries on. But they straightforwardly asked Jesus, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? The disciples saw the suffering as the result of any kind of sin related to him, instead of seeing him as an independent being himself. As many suggest, in Jewish tradition, people see suffering as a result of sin following the fall in Genesis 3. The fall of Adam and Eve was because of their sin disobeying God's instruction. Ever since, the interpretation of human suffering was ingrained in association with sin. When things are really going badly, we still often say with a sigh, what have I done wrong? This theology of the fall and sin actually blinded the disciples because they didn't actually see the man himself. What they saw was the tradition and interpretation of it, not the man himself, with deep suffering that needs to be urgently attended and cared for. In Jesus' response to them, therefore, we have first lesson in terms of what we really have to see out of suffering. That is God's love and grace on him, new possibility beyond all human labeling and stereotyping. Jesus saw him struggling with suffering and approached to him to deliver. In verse 3, neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. It is not because of his sin nor his parents. The suffering of the man is about to acquire a whole new different meaning now, and thus new beginning by meeting with Jesus Christ. Imagine you are the blind man from birth. Throughout your whole life, you are branded and cursed as the man with sin, whether it is yours or your parents, or even before. It seems like there's no hope because you are a born sinner. The blindness from birth is the inescapable sign and the stigma of the sin. The mental pain he experienced must have been unbearable. There in Korea, young people these days often talk cynically about their social status in terms of wealth with some symbols. Young people born wealthy families are often called themselves, or by others, gold spoon. The other ends, earthen spoon, which is spoon made of soil. These days, more and more young people in poverty see themselves as the result of sin of their parents, who just happen to be poor. So they rush it into property and stock market with all what they can stretch or borrow, with huge loans, which is sadly in many cases not going well. Poverty is seen in our society today, so they are branded. What do you see in people suffering? Jesus' reply turned things upside down. No one gave any attention to the man blind from birth. He was ignored as a symbol of sin. He was avoided. But what Jesus saw in him was a whole new possibility. I wonder what would have been going on in the mind of the man when he first heard Jesus' comment on him. The famous rabbi who people often said as the Messiah and the prophet could even stop in front of him to give him an attention. Then what he heard was beyond imagination. It is not because of your sin, my friend. You don't need to be enslaved by what you were repeatedly told. You are precious and you are free now. God will do something special for you. When I go through Jesus' transforming word on him again and again, preparing this message, I cannot but repent on what I have said or viewed on people suffering. I often didn't have the deep sympathy with the picture of new possibilities Jesus had in mind on them. Another lesson we have from the passage today is the urgency of the mission. Jesus clearly knew that he would be soon betrayed and died on the cross. So even the Messiah had to walk diligently in verses 4 to 5. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can walk. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. He saw so many lives were wasted with the wrong doctrine and theology and interpretation of it, and with the physical suffering itself as well. So he had to work hard. He came as the light, and the light has to dispel the deep darkness in their minds. As a study comments on these verses, we don't have many lives. We live one life. So we have to work diligently with urgency. The night is coming soon to everyone. But in Jesus, the light of God, we can walk bravely without fearing the darkness. As the light is sent from the source, Jesus was sent to us from the God, the Father. We are also sent from Jesus. The blind man was sent to the pool of Siloam, which means very fittingly sent. You are the light of the world, Jesus tells his disciples in Matthew 5. Light is available to everyone. It brings warmth and living energy. It makes things come alive. And it doesn't stay where it is. It travels always. Today we are entering into 5 weeks of self-denial. What should be denied in us? What should be given up? My daughter Julie bravely proclaimed that she will deny chocolate for this period, thinking of Christ's pain for us. That's important, very difficult though for me. And Shin says he will reduce gaming time. Well, let's see how they get along. But what is even more important to deny is, I believe, our narrow perspective on people suffering around us. You feel your work is so small, but it brings warmth and living energy in people's heart. I believe that is the light of Christ we can share together. In Matthew 15, Jesus says, "In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Amen. Without light, we can't see. Even with light, we can see things wrong, as did the disciples. But in the light of Christ, we can see what God wants us to see for his saving work. I believe that is true seeing as Christian insight, which I encourage to myself and to you all to practice throughout the self-denial period. Amen. Let us have a moment of prayer and reflection time.
We'll have time to pray with a song, "Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord." The writer of the song, Paul Baloshi, is a contemporary Christian music player, and he was inspired to write this song after reading Ephesians 1:18. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which Christ Jesus has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people. We need this confession and response today. In your hearts, there are the eyes. They have to be opened, to be enlightened, to know the hope of Christ. Many are struggling to see hope these days. While you listen to the song, I encourage you to pray for those you need to bring to the Lord in this moment. It may be yourself, or your family, or friends, people in your community, or someone in the world in our challenging days. Let us pray for them. Lord Jesus, open our eyes in our hearts. We want to see you, to know you as our hope.
Thank you.
Let's share our benediction prayer. This prayer is based from a prayer in the book In the Sanctuary of Women by John Richardson. May God, who comes to us in the things of this world, bless your eyes and be in your seeing. May Christ, who looks upon you with deepest love, bless your eyes and widen your gaze. May the Spirit, who perceives what is and what may yet be, bless your eyes and sharpen your vision. May the sacred three bless your eyes and cause you to see, so you can practice divine seeing in the pain of others, brothers and sisters around you, today through the self-denial weeks and all the days to come. Amen.
Will be forever mine. Will be forever.